أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين أما بعد سلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Well, we have just heard one of the translations of the dua which is to be read in the early hours of Ramadan al-Mubarak. Continuing from the same theme, we were on this particular concept on that night when we were speaking about Sawm and Ramadan. And I said that there is a hijab, there is a veil, as Amir al-Mumineen salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. In Dua Kumail says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ أَنْ لَا تَحْجُبَ عَنْكَ دُعَائِي Ya Allah, I'm asking you that there should be no hijab between me and you caused by my bad and evil deeds and sins. This hijab is that hijab which, after all the majalis that we have, sometimes you can't even count how many majalis we have in a year, how many mu'izah and how many, mashallah, due to the mu'izah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, different types of ulama and zakireen sit on mimbar and they try to enlighten us in matters of faith, religion, our acts and deeds. We see no effect. As if everything is falling on deaf ears. Why is it so? It is so because of that hijab. Imam Jaffer Sadi salawatullah wa salam alayhi. When one does a sin, a black dot appears on his heart. That heart is not necessarily this heart. The heart here is reference to the mind. And if you persist, another dot. And as one goes on persisting, dots after dots, till it becomes totally black. And then you say anything you like, it does not make any effect. Eating of najasat, eating of haram, and many other guna, like speaking lies, accusations, killing someone, a'udhu billah, backbiting, displeasing one's parents, cutting off the relation of the blood relatives, which is called qatiraham, zulm, and how many types of zulm there are. These are the guna which we do. Sometimes we take pride in it. A man dies making a will, leaving nothing for his daughters. He's a zalim. On the day of Qiyamah, he will be asked, what happened to the share of your daughters? Because he doesn't believe that daughters should inherit. That man is a zalim. And he will be asked on the day of Qiyamah, because the daughters cannot do anything. Daughters are already married to their husbands, alhamdulillah. They may be even happier than with whatever money has been left behind by their father. They might not even need that. But their haq is established. Qard. There can be no devolution of estate on the heirs till first the debts are cleared off. They are not cleared. Zulm. Allahumma al'an awwala zalimin zalama haqqa Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Ya Allah, curse him who first laid the foundation of zulm against ali Muhammad. Wa akhira tabi'in lahu ala dhalik. And the next one who followed him. Anyone who does not pay khums is zalim of haqq ali Muhammad. And la'nat goes every Ashura we read 100 times. Because that khums is haqq of Muhammad and al Muhammad salawatullah. And if one looks deeply into his affairs, there is no one exempt from khums. People say, Mara par khums chot tuj nati. But it has no affairs. Sharia wanted us to be very up to date in our matters. That is why the concept of paying khums in advance is not there in Sharia. Many people ask, can I pay in advance? That concept of advance is not there. The concept is that be regular and organized. Have your accounts ready at the end. One day, fix a day, and see what you are worth. Whatever is in excess of what you have spent, legitimate expenditure, lawful expenditure, whatever remained, now pay 20% of that as khums. But when the waivat, as we call in Gujarati, when our own affairs are not organized, then we think of paying either by estimate or we think of payment either in advance. Ayatullah al-Hakim used to say, whoever pays in advance and then later on comes back to know that he has paid more shall have no refund. That was his fatwa. And if he has paid less, he must make that good. Why he said this? Because he says, Shariat's concept is be organized. I am not paying homes. There have been people who wrote in their will, may Allah forgive them, I am not there, but the will came to me, I will that there no homes should be paid from my estate because I don't believe in it. Zulm. In this country, for example, my friends, there are certain things which you do to save inheritance tax. Say a man has willed everything for his wife, not that his wife is the only heir, but by so doing there will be no inheritance tax. Now the wife knows that this was done only for the sake of expediency, that there should be no taxation payable on the estate. There are other haqdar waris also, and she eats up the whole estate. She is valid. For a few days she will enjoy this money. When she dies, she has to answer the haq of everyone else. And this works both ways, husband also. And it works also in the matter of children who try to eat up each other's wealth. Matter of thousands of pounds maybe, or even millions. But my friend, that is where Allah tests me. That where am I? This way or that way? Sometimes you get an offer. Here is an offer, confirmed offer, sealed and signed. Deliver 5 or half a million pound worth of beer and liquor. Here it is. Confirmed. Just sign. And you don't sign saying that this is haram. If you don't sign saying this is haram, then see what Allah gives you without delay. You see, the more bigger the test, the earlier the answer. You see, the daily life we confront with smaller tests. Allah gives the answer, blesses, but that takes its time. But when it is a major test, 5, half a million pound, Baba, Jallatu Jalal tu, Everybody is praying, Ya Allah, 56 crore ni chothai mokal. Oh, half a million. Deal, Mulla sahab, is there any loophole? There is none. Out of Iman, he stands up and says, sorry, I will not do it. It takes Iman and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that this will pass. Ya Abadar, annas yaquluna mali wa maluk. Oh Abu Dhar, people talk my mal, your mal, my wealth, your wealth. Fama laka min malin illa tasaddaqta fa abqayt wa akalta fa afnayt wa albasta fa ablayt. There is nothing more in your mal except that if you gave it charity, of course you caused it to remain. It will come with you. Otherwise you ate and it came out. Or you wore and it was worn out. That's all. Nothing else is yours. Is there anything else? And that which you leave behind, you have no control. Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam says, that whatever you leave behind is not yours. Whatever good they do will be in their amal-e-saleh. You earned it and amal-e-saleh went to them. So my friends, there is a hijab. But this hijab was prevented. That is why you just watch Dua-e Kumail, how it begins. Dua-e Kumail is not an ordinary dua. There are 56 different topics in one Dua-e Kumail. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kulla shay. That is how it begins. I am asking you of your grace, your mercy which has enveloped, which has taken over, which has overwhelmed everything. That means before hijab, he sent rahmat. We removed rahmat and brought in hijab. It was rahmat first. When Musa alayhi salam went to Kohetur, the mountain of Sinai, for the first time, and there was a voice which he heard from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he was invited to come off and on. Once when he went, the wahi came and said, Musa, before I tell you anything, I want to console you. For today, just as you came towards the Mount of Sinai, I commanded that your mother should now die. The mother is dead. The moment Hazrat Musa alayhi salam heard about the death of his mother, he uncontrollably wept. There and there. He wept bitterly. Wahi came, Ya Musa, you have a right to weep over the bereavement of your mother, for the one who stood up at night to pray for you is now gone. The one who stood up at night to pray for my son. Or she woke up and says, Ya Allah, my son, my daughter, my children. The only person who wakes up in the night to remember children is the mother. Now the one who was remembering you is now gone. So be careful in your life. But O Musa, how much did your mother love you? I, as your sustainer, love my servants equal to 40 mothers. 40 mothers. My rahmah envelops you. It guards you from everything. So much so that nothing can harm you. My rahmat is with you. Those of us who these days, I'm so busy in the month of Ramadan and before, not busy with the federation work, no. Not busy with istikhara, no. I'm busy with telephone calls, Mulla sahab, somebody has done something against me. Koye kai kairu che. You see, telephones come that Mulla sahab, somebody has done some magic against me, black magic. There is no black magic, there is rahmah. No one can do any harm to you, you see, but you have a phobia. And human mind is such a strong thing that you can imagine things. You can imagine things and see before you. How many mu'mineen will tell you if, God forbid, their legs have been amputated or hand has been cut off by doctor because of some pain? They will tell you, ask them, that even after amputation there is a feeling of pain. There is a feeling of pain. They go and touch this place, but then they find it is not there. It is called phantom pain, my friends, phantom pain. It has been cut off long ago, but the brain reflex is still working, and that reflex tells you it is paining. While you just put your hand, it is not there, it has been cut off. This is called phantom pain. We have phantoms around us, my friend, phantoms. There is no one to harm you when you are surrounded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah. But in Urdu there is one word. Of course it cannot be translated into English. It has got two meanings. Maulana is sitting here, he will explain to you better. Nigahe ghalat andaz. Nigahe ghalat andaz. Means you look at a person and he misinterprets your looking at him. He may look at you with love and sincerity, but you misinterpret. It's called nigahe ghalat andaz. Now once you have doubted someone, you say, Joy, when I came to Joy, Joy. So when you ask you, here you are, you ask you, here you are. Now you see, it's all in his mind. He thinks that he is looking at me. This is called a nigahe ghalat andaz. You see, and another nigahe ghalat andaz is in ishq. When a male looks at the woman he loves, it's called nigahe ghalat andaz. That's not my subject tonight. This is the subject. You see, nigahe ghalat andaz. We always think, but we forget there is rahmah around us. You see, and whatever happens to me, even, the Prophet said, even if I know that I am going to die, and everybody knows once he's going to die, but suppose somebody died in my family all of a sudden, then here it pains every moment. Not because there's anything wrong here, there's something wrong. Yeah. The phantom tells you now you are also ready. Your clock is not working properly. And gradually it develops into something real and there is a fear of death. This man then goes into Munjaro. Ask him what is wrong with you. He does not know. The doctors will say the pulse is good, the pressure is nice, everything is okay. You see, sugar content is good, salt good. But now what is wrong? Well, you can't find it organically. It's something which is working on his or her mind. He has got to be told only one thing, that death is also rahmah. It will come when he commands. When he commands, there is none to save you. And if he has not commanded, none to take you. What a good answer it is. وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. I mean, you can't get this ayah like this anywhere else. There is no permission for a nafs to die unless permitted by Allah. وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ. No one can die. Illa bi'idhnillah, when he commands. So now, that is why Ali ibn Abi Talib said, Salawatullah, Salamu alayhi. That when you feel something wrong in the chest, he didn't say don't go to doctor, but he said keep your arm here and said, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum. Oh, he who ever lives and ever sustains. Ya la ilaha illa an. There is no God but you. As'aluka an tuhiya kalbi. I am asking you to give life to my kalb. Kalb has got two meanings. The heart and the mind, the sick mind, which always thinks I'm going. The doctor tells you there's no room there, people are coming back. You see, and he makes himself miserable, and his wife miserable, and the children miserable. And when I go there, I say, but why don't you go then? Finish it up, the story is over. I'm going, let them go. But there is no question of going. The question is, the mind is wrecked totally and is wrecking his life into pieces. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, Rahmatin wasi'at kulla shay. Everything is enveloped by his rahmat. Just consider how vulnerable we are to dangers. You came from home to the Imam Bargah. Just consider at how many places we were vulnerable to tragic accidents. Just take one by one. It could have happened here, it could have been that way, it could have happened that. Nothing happened, alhamdulillah, we came here. We are under this structure. So many things can happen in the structure. Alhamdulillah. We finished our program and went home, safe. All this counts in rahmatum minallah. Businesses, some of the transactions transpiring, some of the transactions failing. All that is rahmatum minallah. But it comes upon us when we have seen in the hindsight. But what we are doing and what we really feel in this world immediately is, the Prophet said there are two or three sins. He said four, but I remember three. There are four sins which will be immediately punished, immediately. In this world you will see. And that hijab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like at all. One is zulm. Zulm. Now zulm is such a vast subject. If I stand up to give a witness against someone which is false, it is zulm. False witness. Or if I hide and conceal that witness which I should have given to save him, that is also zulm. Not only money matters. In many things it becomes zulm. We consider it as ordinary. Zulm is immediately repaid. There is a retribution immediately. Secondly, said qat'i raham. Ya Allah, may our community be saved from this. My brother, I don't talk to him. My real brother. One blood, one womb. My sister, I don't talk to her. My mother, she doesn't talk to me, I don't talk to her. Nauzubillah. You see, and then there are so many with whom I am related, consanguinal relation. That means blood relation. The Prophet said, you go and say Salamun Ali. Regardless, he answers or he does not answer. Sil rahamak. You make amends. For raham, do not allow it to be cut off. Because that is something whoever initiates cutting off the relation will see in this world before he goes there. There it is still after all. I mean, can you imagine? Astaghfirullah al-Azim. That the brother is multimillionaire and his sister dies of poverty and the Jamaat arranges for kafan. Can you imagine somebody asks and says, Mulla sahab, I have got sadqa money to give. Send it to India while his own brother in London is starving. Can you imagine? Thousands of pounds for Imam Bargah. For masajid, for schools and all that. And his own relative is starving or is in need of money. So Imam Musa ibn Jaffer for such stages says, he was asked that I have given in charity millions, Yabna Rasulillah. And Imam alayhi salam said, and what happened to Ulul Arham? Ulul Arham? He said, Ya Rasulullah, Ibn Rasulullah, Allah looks after everybody. As you say, Allah Kareem. Imam alayhi salam said, idhan la sadaqata wa la sadaqata wa la sadaqa. There is no charity, no charity, no charity at all. Two. The third is displeasing of your parents. Ajeeb. I mean, this goes exactly against the modern education or whatever, or inculcation, where children are being told to be least mindful of their parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that this is, if mother says, ah, it's all over. If only mother says, ah, she will not say, ah, as long as she can bear. You see, we all know, we all have mothers, head mothers, we all are parents. We know that mother will never say, ah, unless she is extremely displeased. But the moment she says, ah, a sahaba was dying and the Prophet said, قُلْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Sahabi, he is the Prophet's nearest sahaba. Talqeen, I mean, this is sunnah when somebody is dying to say, to try to help him. The Prophet says, قُلْ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And he says, لَا. No. He's a Muslim, huh? قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And he says, no. The Prophet said, has he a mother? They said, yes, but she is totally displeased. She doesn't want to look at him. The Prophet said, yes, but call her here. I want to talk to her. Well, the mother came there and the Prophet said, is it true that you are totally displeased? She said, yes. He said, forgive him. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I wish you had seen how he treated me. I am the mother. I brought him up from that small to whatever he is today. With all that kindness and motherly love, wish you had seen how he treated me. The Prophet said, yes, forgive him. She refused. When she refused, the Prophet said, well then, I am not going to bury him when he dies. I'll put him on fire. When the mother heard this, she said, Ya Rasulullah, no, you can't put my son on fire. He is my son. He is my flesh. The Prophet said, then what I'm telling you, forgive him, because otherwise he is going to Jahannam. Not this fire, that fire. Forgive him. And the mother forgave. The mother forgave. And the Prophet came back and said, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ مُحَمَّدُ رَسُولُ. That is our mother. And we feel that it's all like that. Mother and father's pleasure. Shaykh Abbas Qummi alayhi rahmah writes that one man came to know that whoever does amal for 40 Wednesday nights in Masjid al-Sahla, he gets to see Imam al-Zaman ajjalallahu farajal. Inshallah, if things become good in Iraq, we will go to Sahla. Those of us who are going, they are very lucky and fortunate. Those of us who cannot go, inshallah, will go. But that mosque Sahla has got no parallel in Fadila after Masjid al-Kufa in Iraq. It is the mosque of the prophets, not one or two men. There is one maqam there, this is called maqam Imam al-Zaman, ajjalallahu farajahu al-sharif. And the place where all of us go for salat, maghrib on that night, is maqam Imam al-Jaffer al-Sadiq, right? Forward there, up ahead, is maqam Hazrat al-Hujjat. We went there for 40 Wednesday night, means 10 months. 40 Wednesday night means nearly 10 months. And it means winter as well as summer. But he went faithfully. Only to meet our Imam alayhi salam. And on the 40th night, he went there and came back without having seen Imam Ali. On his way back, it was winter, and it was full of mist and fog and all that. Hardly could you recognize anyone you saw. He saw someone come with a lamp in his hand. Well, this is between Sahla and Kufa, Sahla and Najaf. As the man drew near, he said, Salamu alaykum, alaykum salam. Yes, where have you been? He said, I have been to Sahla. Khair, inshallah. He said, what khair? 10 months' labor has been wasted. I don't know which mullah has brought up this concoction, that whoever will do this will get to see Imam. There is no Imam. It is the 40th. The man who came, who said, do you know one thing? You have an old father who must be looked after every night. You leave him alone and come to see Imam al-Zaman? عليك بالعود عليك بالعود عليك بالعود. عود in Arabic means old father. Wajib upon you to look after your father who is alone. And he disappeared immediately. Then he realized that this is Imam al-Zaman who is telling me, although he met me, but he gave me one wasiya, that your first wajib is to look after your old father. عليك بالعود. Then to come and see. For that is wajib. And the ziyarat of Imam is mustahab. Do we understand this? Uwais al-Qarani wanted to come to see the... He's the only Sahaba. All Sunni and Shia say that Uwais al-Qarani is a Sahaba. Alaki Uwais al-Qarani had not seen the Prophet. You can't be a Sahaba without having seen the Prophet. Sahaba means you must have. Uwais al-Qarani has not seen. But he was there. He told his mother in Yemen, I want to go and see the Prophet. And the mother was very old. She said, you will not go. What happens to me if I die? One day he managed to persuade on a condition that go to Medina, see the Prophet, do not disembark. Just see him. Give my salams to him also. And come back the same way. For I am an old woman, I might die any time. And he was so happy that he came from Yemen to Medina. And the day he came to Medina, the Prophet was in the battle of Uhud. He came and he asked, where is... They said, the Prophet is gone out of Medina. He is in Uhud. And he is in a very critical condition. We have heard that his two teeth have been martyred. Two teeth have been martyred. So he said, which teeth? Upper one, lower one. They said, we don't know, but two teeth have been martyred. He took a stone and hit his mouth. And so many teeth fell down, saying, of course, I could not see him. But my mother has refused me. And he came back. He came back, didn't wait for a moment. He came back to Yemen and mother asked, well, son, did you see him? He said, Ya Umma, you told me not to wait. I could not wait. I have come back. When the Prophet came back, this is the hadith. Bayna sunnah wa shia. The moment he entered Medina, he said, Inni ashummu raihat ar-Rahman min Yaman. I am smelling the fragrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Yaman. Who had come here? Ashummu raihat ar-Rahman min Yaman. I smell fragrance, good smell from Yaman. Divine smell. They told him, Uwais had come and Uwais had gone. Said, yes, he knows what Islam is. For the obedience of his mother was wajib. To look at me was sunnah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.